One more video about I2C EEPROM. Yes, I had some practice working with these devices, and I think it got me to have an easy but fast and affordable handling. So I put here my experiences and result, hoping interesting at least for someone. I will use STM32 with HAL library, handling I2C communication at a high level without needing to go at register level programming the microcontroller. Anyway, I will start analyzing I2C and EEPROM technology in order to understand how to efficiently use HAL APIs. I2C is a two-wire serial bus connecting many devices communicating each other, or on I2C there is one master, and the picture is showing that STM32 can handle a multi-master configuration. A master, I was saying, driving communication to or from the other devices, called slaves. The two wires are used for the clock signal generated by the master and for the data sent by the master to the slave or vice versa. About hardware, we can see also that there are two resistors, one for the clock and one for the data, pulling up the wiring. Being a multi-device bus, each one must have its own address, and communication is enabled by the master, which starts generating clock and sending the slave address to the data wire. Slave reply with an ACK, and then the master starts sending data to the slave or reading it. Using EEPROM, microcontroller acts as a master and EEPROM as a slave. We could go much more deep into detail, but that's enough to start using I2C for our EEPROMs. We need two wire, two resistor, we need to know the slave address, and we just need to know also that I2C works with predefined clock speed in a standard mode at 100 kHz, fast mode in 400 kHz, and fast mode plus at 1 MHz. Now, let's see how works an I2C EEPROM. In this test, I will use this board. It mounts at 156 kilobits EEPROM. These kind of boards are useful while prototyping because they mount a pulling up resistors. So I just need to connect these four pins: VCC, ground, data wire and clock. Developing the final project, I will use EEPROM like this one, same size and characteristics in a DIP case. Referring to the datasheet of the EEPROM, we can see that the manufacturer defined a configurable address, where the first part is fixed and assigned by the manufacturer. The second one is user programmable. As you can see on the device, there are three pins, A0, A1 and A2. And setting these pins to ground or VCC, we can assign the device address. These allow user, in case of need, to have up to 8 different devices connected on the same I2C STM32 port. In our board, these pins are tied to ground, so A0, A1 and A2 have a zero value. The resulting address of the board is hex A0. The last address bit defines the action requested to the device, if it is a writing or a reading. Here, we can see there is a sort of protocol communicating with the device. Writing operation required to send the device address, waiting for an ACK, sending a 2-byte memory address to write on, then sending the data to store. We can also start sending more than 1 byte. EEPROM will increase the device address for each byte received, storing it in a sequential order. But there is a limit to the number of bytes we can send in one command. EEPROM is internally organized in page of 64 bytes, and writing operation can involve just one single page. So, in case the data flow overrides the page boundary, the next byte will be written back to the first page byte. That's an information to keep in mind. OneWrite command involves just one single page of EEPROM memory. After I2C data transmission ends, EEPROM will start the physical writing operation. It is a slow activity, requiring up to 5 milliseconds to complete. During this period, EEPROM freezes, and if requested for a read or write command, it will not reply. That is better described in a different datasheet, like this one, related to a 24512 EEPROM by STM. The 5 millisecond time is something declared as a maximum delay, but datasheet notes that typical time needed is shorter. The same datasheet states, as a good method to know if writing operation ended, polling EEPROM with a command until it replies with an ACK. Reading operation also needs some knowledge. Sending read command to EEPROM, it will start sending bytes read from the memory position where EEPROM did last writing operation. So, if we want to read EEPROM at a specific address, we must start a write operation to the address we want to read, setting this way the EEPROM internal pointer. Then, we just stop the write operation and start to read. EEPROM will continue sending data, incrementing memory position until we stop it. Reading is not limited by the page size. Now we have all the information to start writing code handling I2C communication with EEPROM. Referring to the STM32G4 HAL user manual, we can find all we need to start communication over I2C handling EEPROM, which you have seen is a little complex. But people in ST set two easy functions performing all the operations needed to write I2C EEPROM and read it. Indeed, we have a memory write command and a memory read command, and they are available in polling mode, interrupt mode, and DMA mode. These commands are very easy to use. Just indicate the I2C port you are using, the I2C address of the EEPROM over the bus, the memory address you want to access, the memory address format. Indeed, some devices use an 8-bit addressing, and we know our EEPROM uses a 16-bit format. Pointer to the data buffer to write or storing the data read, the amount of bytes you want to read or write, and timeout. Within it, we expect to end the I2C transmission. In my tests, I will use reading and writing command in polling mode. Note that interrupt and DMA mode just refer to I2C communication, and EEPROM writing activity just start after communication ends. You must test directly EEPROM to check if it completed writing. HAL APIs include a function will perform these controls also. We have the isDeviceReady function returning a status indicating if EEPROM completed writing operation within an assigned timeout. Now we can start working on our project. I use the STM32 Cube IDE and create a new STM32 project. I'm selecting the Nucleo 32 board I'm using and giving a project name. I confirm project creation. I'm confirming the CubeMX preset for the Nucleo 32. Now, I just check the serial wire is enabled for programming and debug. The external clock is disabled, and the microcontroller clock is set to 170 MHz, which is the fastest speed. Now, I'm going enabling the I2C1 port, and I let it to 100 kHz standard mode speed. In my project, I will go to take time needed by the various S2C and EEPROM function. I need to have a microsecond clock, and I can use the C-stick provided by HAL, which is in milliseconds. So I'm using a timer setting each clock to 1 MHz. I need features of a basic timer, so I'm enabling the TIM7 timer. I set the press color to 169, having the base TIM7 counter clock set to 1 MHz. That should be enough. Save and generate the program. Now, let's create a new C file and the new H file, where I will store the EEPROM functions and definitions. I'm adding the new.h file to the main.h, while I'm adding the main.h file in the EEPROM.c file, making available the microcontroller library set by CubeMX. Let me check if everything is working fine. Then I start creating a test function. I will put here the various EEPROMs command to check. I will start with a test reading one single byte from EEPROM. Then a reading of full EEPROM page of 64 bytes. Following is a test writing one byte, a test checking EEPROM availability, a writing of a full page, and a new check for the EEPROM availability. I will add an availability test even before all the other tests, in order to check in the timer of this function when the EEPROM is fully available. For each test, I will store the TIM7 counter value before and after executing command, so I can see the time needed by each command. I will set an array in order to save the timing for all the tests. Now I set up every command. I will define all the parameters in macros in order to easily handle them in all the tests. That is the STM32 I2C port. This one is the EEPROM I2C address. We already have seen that manufacturer assigned the value hex A0. Now I set the parameters of the function isDeviceReady. I'm setting them to one trial of 10 milliseconds. That should be enough. Let me add some more comments. I will store also all the returning status code to check them later. Now I set the memory read command and parameters. Here I specify that address has a 16-bit format. I'm using the related HAL predefined parameter. Here I set a string pointer, and size is 1. That is the I2C timeout. Here also 10 milliseconds should be enough. Now I'm setting the EEPROM page length. The writing command has the same format as the reading one. Now I'm completing the function with the last commands. Compiling program, I see some errors. I forgot to define a macro of the EEPROM address to write into and read from. And I have also to declare as external the I2C port structure. Now I have two warnings, because I never use the array related to function return and timing. Well, we will not use them on compiler point of view, because we will analyze them from the debugger. Now I'm adding as a first step of a function a counter reset command to TIN7. We have to keep in mind that timer and the microcontroller are independent devices. And as I immediately read the counter after the reset, timer could have not completed the reset. So I'm adding a small delay between the request to reset the counter and the next reading. Finally, I'm adding two null operations where I set the breakpoints. Now the function seems complete. I just need to add the function declaration to the header file. Then, into the main, I will start the TIN7 timer clock. And we'll add the test function call. Finally, I can try to run the program. I'm connecting the microcontroller. I load the program to the STM32G4 via the debugger. Going to the first breakpoint and then to the next, program will load the array of timing and results. Let's start analyzing function results. We can see that step 4 got an error. That means that writing was longer than the timeout we set. But we can see that even if we set a very long timeout, retrying to run the test we get the same error on is device ready function. So I try to change the other parameter, number of tests to perform. Setting it to 10. We can see that we have a better result, just a few. So I try to set it to 20. And now is device ready, proceed without errors. Even if I set the timeout back to very low values, is device ready works fine. So it seems that is device ready control, waiting for the EEPROM writing, is just affected by the number of trials we set, and not by the timeout value. Okay, we just need to know how to use it. Now we can have a look to the timing collected. We can see that is device ready is quite fast with a free EEPROM. Then we can see the time needed by 1 byte reading, which obviously is quite faster than a 64 bytes reading. We have also the confirmation that the writing command is faster than the reading one. As we have seen on the datasheet, that reading command is more complex. The last point we note is that is device ready needs the same time writing 1 byte or 64 bytes. The writing operation inside EEPROM involves the full page regardless the number of bytes to write. Now let's try to speed up the I2C communication. I'm going to set it to Fast Mode Plus. As a first result, we still get an error from is device ready, but now we know what we need to do. With a communication 10 times faster, we need 10 times number of trials. It works. Before to proceed, let me add some comments in order to never get into mistakes. Proceeding analyzing timings, we can compare them to the standard mode ones. We can see the same characteristics, a fast device ready over a free EEPROM, and writing and readings depending to the length of the data handled. We also see that is device ready is not related to the I2C speed, it depends to the time EEPROM needs writing a page. On I2C Fast Mode Plus, time to write into EEPROM is much longer than the transmission time, and we know that writing is something done autonomously by EEPROM device. And there is no need to put a control over EEPROM just after sending a writing command. EEPROM will perform writing while the microcontroller proceeds in its program. So I will remove is device ready check after writing. I will put it before writing or reading commands, checking the previous writing, if any, being complete. Now, I can set up my operating function. I could, as example, set up a function writing a string into EEPROM. This function will accept as parameters the EEPROM memory address to start writing and the string pointer to write. I will set up a description helping in a future uses. Warning user that here there is no check about page boundary overriding. Now I just start checking for a free EEPROM. Then I send a writing command. I will write the null character and the string. So, number of characters to write are strlen plus 1. I could also set up a function writing a defined number of characters. I can also set up a reading function. I will read a full EEPROM page into a character array. And so on. Final considerations. About the EEPROM timing, I have to make a change in my function parameters. Have you seen that I need it? We have seen that 200 trials let each device ready to wait correctly until the writing ends. But we have seen also the chip I'm using needs just 2 milliseconds for rewriting. In order to avoid problems in other projects and other devices, I need to keep in consideration that manufacturer states that EEPROM could need up to 5 milliseconds to complete the writing. So I need to raise the number of trials, at least at 500. Again, working with EEPROM, never forgot that a single write command involves just one single EEPROM page. writing a set of data wider than a page will have the EEPROM to restart to the page beginning. Never forget also that a write operation involves always a whole EEPROM page. So, if you have a dataset of some information that you store or change together, instead of having a writing for each parameter, it is better to collect all the info in a struct, making an EEPROM writing just one time. On the other hand, if you have a different parameters to store, unrelated to each other, the safer way to use EEPROM is storing them over independent pages. Finally, if you have to store a large amount of data, overriding a page size, you could move to a different technology, like a flash memory. This is a 64 megabit SPI flash memory. You can see that this device is quite different than an EEPROM, for both the page size and the total size. But the usage of this device goes beyond the topic of this video. So, that's all. I hope you enjoyed this video and found it useful. See you on the next one.